Hey y'all, I'm James Wright and welcome to my shop. Today we are talking about strops. What are they made out of? What should I use as a compound? How do I use them? There are so many choices out there. Let's try and make this a little bit simpler. So let's dive in. The first thing that comes to mind whenever you talk about strops is what material should they be made out of? And the answer is just about anything you want. My preferred material is horse hide, particularly horse butt is a very, very hard, dense material, so it has less chance of rounding over the iron when you're pulling it across it, but it's a very hard material to find. Most of the time I have to call around to a couple different dealers to find the material to make the strops that I sell on my site, but that's my preferred material. If you can't find the horse hide, then a regular cow's hide, vegetable tan leather, works phenomenally. I've actually used my belt in the past. You can pull it out and whip it down there and it works really well. Some people like a softer leather. Paul Sellers particularly likes an open grain leather. Some people say that it will round over the tip of the iron, but it really doesn't cause that much difference, as long as you're not pushing down on it too hard. But if you don't have leather at your disposal, you can even use a scrap of wood, a piece of MDF or pine. You can charge that with your buffing compound and then use that as a strop. It actually works surprisingly well. So you have your scrap of leather and you've cut it to the shape and size that you want. One of the quick questions that I get all the time is, which side do you use? Do you use the smooth side of the leather or the rough side of the leather? And the answer is yes, I actually use both sides. Here you can see I have the rough side here and the smooth side here. A lot of times I will charge the rough side with a compound and I'll strop on that, and then I'll just do a few strokes on the smooth side to give that final polish that the leather can provide, just being a raw smooth leather. Some people will charge the compound on the smooth side. Try it out, see which one you like. Just my personal preference is you charge and use the rough side for 90% of the smoothing, and for my carving tools, I'll bring it over here and do it on the smooth side without any compound at all. The other question I get with the strops I sell on the website is why I don't have them backed onto a piece of wood. Why do I have them free floating? And the reason being is that my bench is a perfectly good piece of wood, and so I can just have this piece that I can lay out, strop down, and be done. It doesn't take up any more space. One of the reasons why I don't actually sell these mounted to a piece of wood is I like to be able to pick them up and bend them over. I use them as the final step in sharpening my gouges. I can bend them to the exact shape of the inside, and I can buff out the inside of the strop. Sort of get a specialized fit for every one of those, whether it be a concave or convex. You can sharpen them pretty quickly and easily just in your hand like that. And also for the V-tools, this one gets a little confusing. How do you get into that corner? And basically all I've done is I use the very edge of the strop, and I'll actually charge that with a compound, and I'll run that in on the inside of the V-tool, just like that. Doesn't take that much. Actually, on this one, I came through and I shaved it at a slight angle because this V-tool is a little bit tighter. So you can run on the inside of the V-tool as well. So having them free floating like this makes it very easy to then strop while you're carving, because when you're carving, you have all of these weird geometries that become very easy. You can just pick them up and run them in your hand to whatever shape and size you have. I don't have to worry about having a wooden backer that fits that shape. I can bend this to any shape that I want and still be able to then take it over here, lay it flat, and use it for regular bench chisels. The strops I sell on my website, I actually shape them to be the same size as the DMT plates that I use here. They're both 3-inch by 8-inch, and that way it fits in size 1, 2, 3, 4. The next thing we need to talk about before we get into actually how do you use a strop is buffing compound. And there are a myriad of different types out there, and you can buy them different colors of white and red and green and black and orange. And everyone out there has their own preferred preference. The most common one you're going to find is green. That's chrome oxide. I've also used the black, which I believe is zinc oxide. There's a bunch of different oxides, iron oxide, aluminum oxide, and each of them will work differently. Some of them cut a little bit faster. Some of them are a little bit better polisher. I find the green to be the most even one all around. It's the one I generally use the most. It's a good polisher and it cuts at a decent speed. And that's also what I sell with my strops on the website. With any of the compounds, you can make your own. They're basically just the compound suspended in a wax. And I'll have a video coming up soon where I can show how I make these. And I want to do one where I'm actually pouring them into different molds. So if you guys want to see that, let me know. I thought doing some carbonite compound would be kind of fun. For charging the strop with compound, I just use it like a crayon and fill it in like this. And that's about it. And once the strop has been charged a good while, this will last a long time. This crayon will probably last me another 4, 5, maybe 6 years of use. This one, when I first got it, was only about that long, and that was about 3 years ago. So they last a long time. One of the things particularly that I like about the green is as it gets used, it turns black, and that's from the iron of the steel actually getting embedded into it. And so if it gets too thick, you can actually scrape it off with a card scraper, and you can see I get back down to that green and I can recharge it and keep on going. I find that the rough side actually holds the compound far better than the smooth side. It tends to break off a little bit easier. So that's why I generally strop on the rough side. But some people really like the smooth side. You're just gonna use a little bit more compound on the smooth side than on the rough side of the leather. Now that we've talked about the type of strop and the compound that goes on, let's talk about using them. I have this one. This is a sharpening station that I made a while ago so I can go from coarse, medium, fine, and then on the strop. That way it's the same maneuver all the way through these, and then I can get that final polish I need on the strop. So if you keep using this strop and you don't let the chisel get too dull, there's no real reason to go back to these stones. You can just keep it sharp by doing another 30 or 40 strokes on one side, and then I'll flip it over and I'll pull the burr off on the other side, 5 or 6 strokes on the back, and we're good to go and on the road. It really doesn't take that much to shine it up. My last plate here is equivalent to about a 1200 grit whetstone-ish, but diamonds cut very differently. So I go straight from this onto the strop. I know some people who go from like 500 grit onto a strop. If your strop is cutting well enough, this is all you really need. A few strokes on that and it's ready to go to town. I have to be careful sometimes when running the strop is if I go too fast, I come back and then the chisel will gouge into the strop on the forward stroke. So you want to be careful of not going too forward, or sometimes I'll pull it back and my forward stroke catches the back of this and I'll actually shear it up. This is the old one I had here, and you can see several places where the chisel has caught it over time and actually sheared up the leather. Not a huge issue, as the more I come back across it, the more that is going to lay down. To me, the strop really is a vital part of any hand tool shop. It is the final thing that touches the iron before it goes to work. It is, in many cases, the only thing that has to touch the iron to keep it up and running as long as you sharpen it more often. It is, in many cases, the only thing that has to touch the iron as long as you don't let the iron go too far and keep it sharp. This will do 90% of the work for you. So that's why on the bench, I often have one or two strops, especially if I'm carving. I'll have this one out here that I can very quickly go through the strokes and sharpen it up without having to worry about it. If I'm doing a lot of mortise work, I'll just leave the strop on here, and every 2 to 3 minutes, I'm gonna stop, strop it 30 strokes or so, and go right back to work, and I can keep a really nice honed edge that will cut beautifully every time. For many people, the subject of strops is extremely confusing, and I don't want it to be that way. I know I've gone through all these options and all these materials, and it really isn't that much. It's just a final smooth surface that you can run the iron over. Something that is porous enough to hold a buffing compound, and you're good to go. So whether you're just getting started and you want to use the belt that you're wearing as your strop, or you're going to go get a piece of MDF, or you want to go buy a horse butt strop, there isn't a huge amount of difference that people notice until they've been doing it for a while. And once you've been doing it for a while, then you'll notice all the little finities of a really hard leather as opposed to a soft leather, as opposed to different types of buffing compounds you can experiment with. And really, you can experiment and try different things, and you never know until you like it. This is what I like, a horse butt strop with a chrome oxide. That makes me happy. But other people out there like something very different, and you're never gonna know until you actually get a chance to try it. So go out and experiment and see what you like. Now, if all of this is too confusing for you and you just want something simple, you can go to my website and actually buy a strop and honing compound. I sell them as a kit. I try to make them as affordable as I can. And so you can actually go and buy exactly what I use and what I like to work with. Now, the last two times I've made them, I've sold out of stock almost instantly. And so I'm actually doing a pre-order this time. So if you go to my website and order one right now, I'm going to be making them the end of this month. And you can get in on that order right now. I don't know when I'm going to be making them after that, so if you want them, jump on that. There you have it, strops. Whether they are complicated or simple, don't overthink them that much. It's just that final step that gives you that beautiful polish on a chisel. And they make me very happy every time. The first time I actually started using a strop completely changed my world and made me change my mind as to what actually sharp is. It's a phenomenal thing to have in your shop. And if you do want to find out more about this, I have links to the strops that I sell, as well as some of the other resources and places where you can buy things down in the description below. So I hope you like this video. And if you have any questions or ideas, I'd love to hear what you think is your favorite way of stropping, what material, what compound. Let me know down below, and let's get this ball rolling. So that's about it for today. Until next time, have a wonderful day. 3, 2, 1, strop. In the name of love, before you break my chisel,